This call is being recorded.
Hello? Good morning. Welcome to The Color of Victory. Is anyone there?
Yes, it's Juliet. Is anybody else?
Good morning.
Good morning.
We had a little bit of technical difficulty this morning.
Oh. And everyone, this is Lisa.
Good morning, Lisa. Sorry about the technical difficulty.
Good morning, this is Veronica.
Good morning, Sister Veronica.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Declare Victory. Good morning. Welcome to Declare Victory. Did anyone else join the call?
Good morning.
Good morning, Moni. Good morning, everybody. Happy Memorial Day. It's Yolandra. Good morning, Yolandra.
Good morning, Moni.
Good morning, Moni.
Good morning, Susie.
I knew that was you, Moni.
Anyone else join the call?
Good morning. This is Delivered Demetra.
Good morning, Delivered Demetra. Welcome to Declare Victory. Did anyone else join the call?
Oh, we're going to get started, and I am filling in for Leticia from Arizona. And welcome, everyone. Welcome this morning. Thank you for joining us here on Declare Victory. And we have some announcements. Declare Victory has an app now, and it is up and running. And please visit the Victory Room, because this app is our new prayer app. And just go ahead and review the information that's there that's going to help everyone to be able to submit their prayer requests electronically. So please look out in the Victory Room later today. I will be posting all the information, and it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be great. And there are no prayer requests right now from that app. There is one prayer request that I was trying to get to about Jeff and Pretty Patrice. I believe their son was in a motorcycle accident. So if we could all please continue to pray on that. And if we could continue to pray on that throughout the day until we get an update, that would be great. So we thank you for that. And I'm going to read the lineup. The lineup for today is, scripture will be read by the Mrs. The declaration will be brought to us by Pamela. And praying first will be Yolandra. And praying second will be Dion. And I'll repeat that order. Scripture will be brought to us by the Mrs. The declaration will be brought to us by Pamela. Praying first will be Yolandra. Praying second will be Dion. And again, I want to apologize for the delay that occurred this morning. That was just a little bit of technical difficulty, and that shouldn't happen again. So please don't forget to mute your line. And please check it throughout the call, because we are recording, and we don't want any interruption. So thank you for calling. Thank you for joining us this morning. And I am going to now pass the call to the scripture reader, the Mrs.
And I'm going to, right before the scripture reader jumps in, what I'm going to do is I'm going to modify our time, only because I'm sure people were probably a little bit thrown off by the call. So we've had so many people call in and hang up, and I'm sure that they were assuming that because of the holiday, we don't have a call, but they don't know us very well. Either way, Pamela, if you want to, you can do maybe a modified declaration, and we'll pray, and then there will be no Love, Life, and Victory call. Amen. All right, go ahead, whoever has the scripture.
The Lord has taken you and brought you out of the iron furnace from Egypt to be a people for his own possession. Deuteronomy 4:20. May the Lord bless the reading and hearers of this word as I pass the call.
Good morning. It was really good to be able to call in this morning. I know it was a little frustrating getting in, but that's the way the enemy is, and it's kind of right on time with regards to this declaration. Thank you, Moni, for filling in, being our greeter and host this morning, and to the missus for the scripture. This morning, today's Memorial Day, and it's a solemn day of remembrance, and it's a day in which we pay honor and homage to those men and women who have given their lives. They've lived lives of servants and sacrifice for a purpose that they believed in that was greater than themselves. And I remember back in 2004, there was a news of a soldier from my hometown who was killed in action back in the Middle East. And there was something unique about this particular soldier. His name was Cat Tillman. And what he did was really extraordinary. He had so much in his life. In fact, he was drafted in the NFL by the Arizona Cardinals back in like 1998. And he won this strong safety position. And he broke the record for like the most tackles in 2004. And he was kind of at the top of his game. And he was making like over $3.6 million. He was a Super Bowl champion. And even the St. Louis Rams were like after him and offering him like three times as much money. But Pat Tillman, even though he was living the American dream after September the 11th attacks, he felt this higher call on his life. And so at the age of 25, he walked away from the NFL, trading that multi-million dollar contract for $18,000 a year as an Army Ranger. And he didn't really make a big deal about it. In fact, he kind of kept it really quiet out of the press. He only told his friends and his family, you know, what was he was doing and that he really wanted to give back to his country. Tragically, 2 years later, Tillman was killed 25 miles from his military base in Khaskal, Afghanistan. And in the wake of his death, the papers begin to post comments from his fellow players and soldiers and leaders. And it was his agent who said something that was so profound. He wrote about how he was an impact player and how in this business as a football player, he was considered this impact player. But he talked about how Tillman was actually an impact person and that he stood up against all odds and he stepped out and decided to serve his country. And he made such an impact on his whole troop that he was with. And so this morning I kind of want to talk about another impact person who was a quiet hero in the Bible. You know, he wasn't somebody who was really well known like Abraham or Moses. He was just an ordinary person like you and I, and he was a common man who did some really uncommon things, and it was because he really trusted God. And if we really look at the lessons of his life and we really put them in practice, we can begin to see how if we trust God, that in spite of difficult times, in spite of situations that we may go through, that God can use us in a miraculous way. And this particular person I want to talk to you about this morning is Gideon. Gideon, you find his story in Judges chapter 6 through 7. And I want to talk this morning, like I said, about trusting God through hard times. And the scripture, again, like I said, is Judges 6 through 8. And this particular text, I really want to talk about like the lessons that can help us trust God more during hard times. Because God used tough times to kind of get our attention. And in verses like 1 through 6, we kind of find the nation of Israel coming off of like a really difficult time. A difficult time where they're, because of their disobedience, God gave them into the hands of the Midianites. How often has that kind of happened to us? You know, we find ourselves losing sight of God, or we find ourselves not trusting God, and God kind of shakes things up in our lives, and we find ourselves going through some difficult times, not because we're doing right, but because, you know, we have chosen not walk in the sight of God, not to walk according to what God is calling us to do. And that's what kind of happened to the Israelites for 7 years. They were being oppressed by the Midianites. And every year around harvest time, the Midianites would invade Israel, and they would begin to steal all of their crops and their animals, and they would ravage the land, and whatever they couldn't carry with them, they began to destroy. And it got so bad that the Israelites left their homes and they lived in caves. They feared for their lives. And this, like I said, this went on for 7 years. And finally, the Israelites cried out to God for help. Many would wonder, like, why did they wait so long to cry out to God? And I think a lot, it's because they kind of, a lot like us, you know, they kind of waited until they couldn't take it anymore. So often when we find ourselves in situations, we try to fix it ourselves, and we try the best way that we can. And we see them fleeing up into caves, you know, they're constantly trying to rectify the situation to make it better for themselves. And instead of stopping and just falling on their knees and crying out to God earlier, it took 7 years. And they held out thinking that they could handle it. And it wasn't until that they cried out unto God that God rose up a judge, a man named Gideon, to deliver them from the Midianites. And what we find out is that when tough times come, instead of being concerned as to, you know, what's happening, or being worried about God, whether it's God punishing you or not, you know, it's important that we begin to bow down and just pray to God and just ask God to deliver us. It's interesting because many will say that the Lord will, when he loves us, he disciplines those that he loves. And that's true. But as Christians, we need to trust God and walk in his way, and make sure that we're not being disobedient. And what was happening with the children of Israel was they began to forget what God had done for them. They forgot about how he had delivered them out of the hands of Pharaoh, and they forgot all that he had done for them, and they had forgot what happened during the reign of Deborah. And they began to worship idols again. And they were worshiping this idol Baal. And so God took his hands off of them and allowed the Midianites to rise up against them. And it wasn't until they, like I said, they prayed, they reached out and began to pray unto God. And they cried out to God. he began to move in mercy and love towards them. And he does the same for us. And he began to work behind the scenes and began to rise up another leader to help deliver them. And like I said, that leader was Gideon. But it's interesting when you begin to look at Gideon's story, because in the first couple of verses, you know, we see how they were being taken advantage of by the Midianites. But then when God raised up Midian, we see where Midian is. And the text says that Midian was in the wine, in the wine stocks, like trying to take care of the wheat, thresh the wheat. And it's interesting because he was down in there. I'm trying to find the verse. but he's in this underground wine press trying to take care of the wheat. And it's really kind of a place, like typically when you're doing the wheat and sifting the wheat, you're up on a high area, like in a mountain area. But because he didn't want the Midianites to find him, he chose to go down below. And it was almost like this weak, cowardly person who was down in this cave down below trying to sift the wheat to avoid the Midianites from stealing this. Now, the angel of the Lord came to him and told him that he needed to rise up and that he was going to use him. And Gideon was kind of, you know, in a maze. He began to try to make excuses, saying, you know, he came from a family that was weak and that he was the youngest. And God began to tell him, you know, no, you know, I want to use you. And he called him a mighty warrior. And as I stated that, you know, here Gideon is down below taking care of the wheat, and God is calling him this mighty warrior. And it's interesting because there's times in our lives when we feel weak, when we feel that we're inadequate, when we feel we're not capable of doing anything. And instead of God seeing us as that weak, frail individual, God sees us for who we will become. He sees us through the eyes of the future, what will be. And so he calls Midian this mighty warrior, this man of valor, and he begins to see this true identity of who he was going to be. And Midian didn't even catch that when the angel came to him. He didn't even catch it that he called him a mighty warrior. And that's in verse 12. But what Midian began to do was he began to question God. He was kind of like, well, if you are really God, then what happened to you? Like, why is all this happening to us? And, you know, you were there for our ancestors, and you took care of everything for our ancestors, but why is it that, you know, you've allowed us to, you know, fall upon these hard times? You know, what's going on? And so God turned to him, and he told him, go with the strength that you have and rescue the Israelites and the Midianites, for I am sending you. God wants to send us out into the world. God wants to send us, but it's up to us to trust him, and it's up to us to be obedient and to begin to walk into what God actually sees us,
who he actually sees us to be. But like I said, many a night, like I said, Gideon immediately began to complain and began to talk about the fact that he was weak and that his tribe was, you know, one of the weakest tribes. But the Lord said to him that I will be with you and you will destroy the Midianites. And if you, he told him that you would strike the Midianites as if it was one man. But Gideon began to say, you know, if you truly will help me, then you need to show me a sign. How often do we do that? How often do we ask God, you know, show me a sign? You know, I don't believe this is you. You know, if you really want me to pursue this great ministry, if you really want me to go out and do this, you know, I need to see a sign from you. So God tells him, you know, this is what I want you to do. I want you to, you know, there's some things happening in your house that I want you to destroy. You know, you guys are worshiping this idol, and I need you to destroy it. And once you take care of what's happening in your house and destroy that and get rid of that, you know, I will show you how I can use you and how I can deliver you. And it's interesting because so often, you know, God is preparing us for the world and God is preparing us for great things. But there's something that we need to do within sometimes our own household, within our family. You know, when we're out in the world and we're at our churches or in our ministries, you know, we begin to speak one way, but when we're at home, we're doing something totally different. And so God is saying, you know, there's some stuff happening at home that you need to take care of first before I can use you. And once you take care of that at home, then I can use you. And so Gideon took 10 men with him, and he went to destroy this idol that was being used. But it's interesting because he was so fearful and timid to go during the middle of the day that he decided to go at night. And so he went at night with the 10 men to destroy this idol. And right away the next day when they questioned who did it, you know, and found out that it was Gideon, you know, it's just interesting that when God calls us to do something, you know, rather than walking and doing it in boldness, you know, he was still fearful. But the good news is that God uses those who are inadequate. God uses those who feel incapable or feel like they can't quite do it. But if you trust God and are obedient and get our houses in order, then God can use us mightily. So Gideon began to, like I said, destroy this idol. And he was still showing that he was a coward. Now here, God sees him as this mighty warrior, but he's still envisioning himself as this coward because he's going out at night trying not to be spotted by the town. But God tells him, you know, even though you, you know, went at nighttime, you know, that's okay. I still want to use you. But Gideon once again needs to see another sign. You know, how often do we do that? Do we continue to question, is this really you, God? You know, I need to see another sign. I need to see that it's really you. So the angel told him, you know, I need you to bring a fleece. And Gideon begins to tell him, you know, like if the fleece is wet and the ground is dry, the next morning when I put this fleece down, then I'll know that you really want to use me. I know that it's you who's speaking to me. I'll be obedient. I'll follow you. And so that night, he puts his fleece out at night. And the next morning when he gets up, the fleece is soaked and wet and the ground all around it is dry. And so Gideon, once again, you know, says to God again, you know, you know, that could have happened, you know, as happenstance, you know, because of the dew or whatever, you know, the fleece could have just become wet. But let's try this again. And if the ground is wet and the fleece is dry, then I'll know it's you. And so the very next night, he puts the fleece back out again. And the fleece was dry and the ground was soaked. And so early that next morning, Gideon began to take this huge step of faith and began to believe that God is really, truly calling him. And so he takes all of these men who were ready to go down to fight against the Midianites and to take them on. God said, wait a minute. You know, I need you to stop because you have too many men. And I need you to take another step of trust and faith in me. Because I promised that I would save Israel through you. But I need you to trust me, and I need you to cut down the amount of men that you're taking, because I don't want the Midianites to feel that you won because you overpowered them, but I want them to know that you won because God delivered them into your hands. And so Gideon began to think, like, what? Are you kidding me? Like, you want me to cut the men down? But it's interesting as we look through the story of Gideon through chapters 6 and 7, and we begin to see, you know, this ordinary man who was dealing with his inadequacies, who, and even though he questioned God, you know, he still began to move in obedience. He began to move in obedience and he continued to do what God asked of him to do. And that's what God wants from us. He just wants our obedience. He wants us to trust him every step of the way. And there's kind of three things that took place in this whole chapters of 6 and 7. You know, it started off with them praying to God. And oftentimes we miss God because there's lack of prayer in our lives. And so God really needs us to step out and trust him by praying to him and developing this relationship with him and relying on him to solve our problems and not to try to fix things on ourselves. And then secondly, he needs us to be obedient. You know, as we move in trusting God and relying on him to do everything that he said he would do, he needs us to be obedient. And like I said, even though Gideon was kind of reluctant, and even though he felt inadequate, very much like Moses and Jeremiah and several of the prophets and those in the Bible who God used in such mighty ways, because if we are able to do it, God can't use us because then we'll think we did it in our own power. But he needs us to be obedient. And all along the way, Gideon was obedient. He was obedient when he burnt the idol that was in his house. He was obedient when he followed his instructions and did the fleece, put the fleece out. He was obedient when he started cutting down the amount of men, and he just trusted that God would do what he said he would do. And the third thing that we see happening in this particular text was, you know, the prayer, the obedience, And the third thing was how he, when you lack faith, when you lack that trust and faith in God, you know, that will stop us from being blessed. That will stop God from using us. But God can, Gideon continued in his trust in God, and he continued to trust God all the way, every step of the way, he continued to trust God. So I just want to encourage us to make sure that that we're constantly in prayer, that we're constantly obedient to what God wants to do with us, and that we're constantly operating and trusting God every step of the way. Because God wants to use us in such a mighty way. God sees us as phenomenal men and women of God. God sees us as mighty warriors, even though we don't feel that way ourselves, even though we might feel inadequate. Recently, my son and I kind of ventured out into this business venture, and we started this business, and we had a few successes, but over the last week, we got tied up in a contract that we were, I was fearful that, you know, we might get stuck. And, you know, I remember just kind of like crying out to God, going like, what is going on? Like, I thought this is what you wanted us to do. And, you know, I began to feel really inadequate. Even though God had prepared us all along the way, I began to feel really inadequate. And God, you know, had to stop me and said, you know, you need to trust me. You need to trust that I'm going to do what I told you I was going to do when I called you guys to do this and to step out and to move into this direction with this business. And so, sure enough, you know, God began to slowly work it out in our favor. And so I just want to encourage us all to just trust God in spite of the hard times, in spite of the difficult times, if we continue to put our trust in God. Just as Gideon, God delivered the Israelites for 40 years because of his obedience, because he trusted God. So I want to encourage us to trust God in the midst of our difficult times as I pass the call.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Pamela, for your declaration this morning. Thank you, Lord, for another day, God, another beautiful day on this side, Lord. We praise you this morning. We are humble this morning, and we always, always, always acknowledge who you are in our lives, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Lord, we are grateful, and help us to remember that our faith, Lord, should always be stronger than our feelings, Lord, that we do not lean into our own understanding, but that we trust you. We trust you with all our mind and our heart and our soul and our spirit, with all our being, Lord, because we know that you can do anything, Lord. You don't need us. You don't need us to do anything, Lord God. But everything we do is for your glory. So you work through us, Lord. You take the most humble one, Lord God, to show your strength and your might and your glory, Lord. Help us to remember, Lord God, that our obedience is better than sacrifice, Lord God. I thank you, God, for this morning. I thank you for this day. I thank you for the breath in our bodies. I thank you for the soundness of our mind, Lord. And I thank you for our obedience, Lord, for you, to you, Lord God, for your people, Lord God. So I just thank you for the blood that was shed for our sakes, Lord. I thank you for your stripes, for through your stripes we are healed, Lord God. And I just thank you, Father God. I thank you for those people who are on the call, my prayer warriors this morning, Lord. Those who weren't able to make the call this morning, Lord God. I just ask that you will remember us this day, Lord. Protect and guide us this day, Lord Jesus. thank you, Lord God. I pray for those who are suffering, Lord God, with illnesses and diseases of the mind, Lord God, and homelessness, Lord God, and our veterans and our military. This day, Lord, we remember those who have lost their lives for our sakes, Lord God, for this country and for its safety, Lord God. Lord, everything comes through you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, for baby Vanessa, Lord, for her testimony, Lord God, that her tumor has shrunk, Lord God. And though she's not out of the force yet, Lord God, I just thank you for that magnificent testimony, Lord God, that she, her tumor has gotten smaller, Lord, through our prayers, Lord, through our faith, Lord. We can testify that you are still the great healer, Lord. We don't forget Josiah this morning, Lord God. We thank you for his testimony. We thank you for his life this morning, Lord God. We just thank you, and we continue to be on our knees, Lord, on our faith, on our knees and on our face, rather, Lord God, for Josiah, Lord God. I pray for Cecile Benson, for she has cancer, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you will just continue to heal her, touch her, comfort her, be with her right now in the name of Jesus. I pray for David Thompson, Lord God, who has cancer, Lord Jesus. I pray that you will deliver him, Lord, like you did 8 years ago, Lord God, if it be your will, Lord God. We are praying for your majesty, for your might, for your healing power, Lord God. I pray for Deborah Giles Powell, Lord God, that you will do the same for her, Lord. Whatever it is, Lord, that you will eradicate any cancerous cell from her body right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, your word says that you have not given us a spirit of fear, Lord God, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's 2 Timothy 1, verse 7, Lord God. Lord God, I will believe that you are God, that there is no one like you, that when we declare that you are the one that declares from the end to the beginning, who plans and brings to pass all that you have purposed. That's Isaiah 46, 9 and 11. Lord God, I will believe that our God is the King of glory, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. That's Psalms 24 and 8. That he's the one who fights for me, Lord God. You fight for me, Lord. You go before me, Lord God. You purpose me, Lord God. But you go before me with a clear path, Lord, that if I am obedient, Lord, if I am trusting, Lord God, if I believe in you, Lord, despite what I see, Lord God, that you will purpose my path, Lord, I will believe that God is able to do far more abundantly above all that I ask for. Think, and according to the works that is within me, that's Ephesians 3 and 20, I will believe that God is for me, that nothing can separate me from the love of Christ, that I overwhelmingly conquer through Christ who loves me, Romans 8 and 37. I will believe that God causes all things to work together for good because I love him and that I'm called according to his purpose, Romans 8, 28. I will believe that trials in my life are producing endurance, and I consider it joy because it means I'll be perfect and complete and lacking in nothing, James 1, 2 through 4. I will believe that God is with me always, Matthew 28 and 20. That if I believe he is with me, I need not fear, Isaiah 41 and 10. I will believe that nothing, absolutely nothing, is too difficult for God. That's Jeremiah 32, verse 27. I will believe, yes, I will believe that with God all things are possible. Lord God, we trust in you. This is the month of trust, Lord. So we are building upon our trust, Lord God. I trust you, Lord Jesus. And I trust, Lord God, that my faith is always stronger than what I feel, Lord God, that I will not believe in what I see, that when difficulties approach me, Lord, and if I tend to cower, Lord God, and I get fearful, that I will remember your word, I will remember your promise, and I remember that Jesus died for me, Lord God, and I remember that I have a purpose, Lord God, that nothing can stop me from what is purposed for me in my life. For everyone who believes in you, Lord, you have never forsaken them, Lord. We trust in your word. We know your name. And you have never forsaken those who seek you, Lord God. So we humble ourselves right now, Lord God. We humble ourselves and we turn from our wicked ways so that you will acknowledge, you will see us, Lord God, and forget us not. So we thank you this day, Lord God. We praise your name, for you are beautiful, Lord God. You are wonderful, Lord God. You are my Savior and the lover of my soul. And I thank you for remembering me, Lord God. I thank you for remembering all of us under the sound of my voice, Lord God, as I pass the call. Hallelujah, amen, and praise Jesus. Thank you, God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. And so, God, we bless you. And we thank you. God, you are great and greatly to be praised. God, I thank you for everyone that is on the line today. I thank you, oh God, for the share this morning. I thank you for Pamela. And I thank you for those that pursued and were patient in the process, Lord God. I thank you that we learn how to overcome all of our tribulations, overcome all of our trials. I thank you, Lord God, that you've given us strength and courage. God, you said in your word, Psalms 13:5, but I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. This morning, God, we trust in your unfailing love. We trust that you cannot fail or falter, but I trust in you, Lord. I say you are my God. We bless you this morning, God, because we don't have to fret, nor do we have to fear. When we're afraid, we put our trust in you, oh God. Lord Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you. God, we thank you this morning that we can stand on your words. We thank you this morning that, God, there's no weapon that will ever form that can separate us from who you are and your love for us. We thank you, God, that no matter how we feel, your word is still solid and sure. We thank you, God, that you always make a way out of no way, even when we don't get it. God, I thank you so much that we don't have to trust in the worthless words of others. God, but that your word is a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. God, I thank you that we don't have to let our hearts be troubled, that we believe in God and we believe in the Son. God, we thank you this morning that we don't have to be consumed by what we see. We don't have to be moved or threatened by what we hear or what we might fear. God, we don't even have to be uncomfortable when situations and circumstances come. That sometimes, God, they come just to make us stronger. And faith worketh patience. God, I thank you you're working patience in all of us. I thank you, oh God, that we can lean and depend on you, that we can lean and depend on your word, that we can rest and trust in your word for our lives. I thank you, oh God, that even as we learn how to war, as we learn how to fight, Lord God, that at the end of the day, you fight for us. God, that we might physically have to open up our mouths, but ultimately you have the final say. God, and so this morning, we thank you that as Pamela pressed through and shared from her heart, oh God, in the middle of her storm, God, we recognize not everything has to be rebuked or revolted, Lord God, but that sometimes you are simply teaching us to trust in you with all of our hearts and lean not to our own understanding, but learning how to, in all of our ways, acknowledge you so that you can direct our paths. God, I thank you this morning for strategy. I thank you this morning for fresh downloads and rhema words, Lord God. I thank you for right now and your perfect timing in helping us to evolve and to become, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that we don't have to falter or be consumed by situations and circumstances, Lord God, but that you work all things together for the good of them that love you. God, thank you this morning for even the opportunity to love you. Thank you for the mindset to trust you with all that we are, with all that we have, so that you can get the glory out of our lives. God, we bless your name this morning. We give you glory and honor this morning because surely you are our God. God, for every person that's sick and shut in,
God, and I even pray this morning for Pamela in her body, oh God. You know everything that's going on. I thank you, God, that you're well able, that you are Jehovah Rapha. You can and will heal, oh God. I thank you, Lord God, for her resilience, God. I thank you for her snapback. I thank you for her tenacity in the name of Jesus. God, for those that are suffering, I pray this morning even for pretty Patrice and Jeff and for their boy. God, I thank you, God, that the circumstances were minimal and that you yet kept your hand on him. Lord God, while he's down, speak to his heart in the name of Jesus. Continue to minister to him. God, from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, he shall recover. And so we thank you this morning that we can call on you, God, when husband isn't acting right, God, when children seem to be gone wayward, God, when finances seem like they are running out or not enough, Lord God, that you still meet every single need. I bless you this morning, oh God, that your word declares that we shall suffer no lack. I thank you, oh God, that even when it looks uncomfortable, that we won't fret nor fear, Lord God, but that we'll stand on the promises of our great and awesome King. And as we all begin to take our phones off mute,
hallelujah,
God,
hallelujah.
God,
and
bless your name.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
God, we declare that we are
God. And for you, Lord God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God.
And only your word, Lord God. Trusting in you, Lord, that you will do it. I purpose us to you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Remind
us that you are the present.
You are amazing, Lord. You are amazing.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise your name. Mighty is your name. Magnificent is your name. Thank you, Lord. Heal your land, Lord. Heal your people, Lord. Save us from our sins, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise your name. Praise your name, I praise your name. Believe in you, Lord God. Believe in you, Lord God. Everything starts with our belief, Lord God. We just praise your name this morning, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You do your people, Lord God. Thank you, God.
Glorify you and magnify you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord.
Mighty God.
All this day. Bow down before you. Let's humble ourselves this day, Lord God. Thank you for another day that was promised. We rejoice.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, help us remember you that you can do all things. We can do all things. We just thank you for this day, Lord God. I pray that you overcome us, that you overtake us, Lord God. That your spirit will just
fill us, Jesus, Jesus,
in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father God. Bless the baby, Lord God. Bless the teachers, Lord God. Bless Vanessa, Lord. Are not carnal, Lord God. Bless Achille, Lord God. Little Lucy and Ariana, Lord God. Bless the babies, Lord God. Messiah, Lord God. Remember your people who are called by your name, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God.
Jesus.
Jeff's son, Lord. Remember him, Lord God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless your name. Bless your name. Thank you for the healing that you're going to deliver to us right now. In the name of Jesus. I'm so grateful.
Oh,
Good morning, Tracy.
Are there any birthdays or anniversaries that we can acknowledge today?
Well, good morning. This is Kedra. Baby Olivia was born 7 pounds, 3 ounces, so we thank God for her life. And yesterday was my sister's birthday. She turned the big 40, so happy birthday to Tanisha, and welcome back to the world, baby Olivia.
Yes, welcome, baby Olivia.
Hallelujah.
And happy birthday to your sister.
And really quick before she hangs up, Miss Pammy had a birthday. Pam Mason had a birthday, I think, Thursday or Wednesday. I don't know. I know it was last week, and I know she wasn't on the call. So just wanted
it
to
was. Thank birthday. You. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
Thank you. God bless.
Amen. Good morning, Victory Family. Thank you guys for the prayers for Dominique. He got busted up a little bit, needs stitches in his head, but God is good. It could have been a lot worse, so we thank you for your prayers.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Is there anyone else that has a praise report that they want to share right now? Any other praise reports?
Yeah, I have one. This is Juliet. Hi, everybody.
Go ahead, Juliet.
Well, yesterday was my grandson's birthday, Tiberius. We went up on Saturday because he was being blessed. So when we got there, not only was he being blessed, but my son, who just got his master's the week before, they ordained him a deacon. And that was a beautiful moment. So that's my testimony right there. It was just, you know, we didn't see it coming. I'm just looking at how God is just blessing my son.
Wow. Look at God. Look at God.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Amen.
Hey, Moni, I have a testimony. It's really a thank you. I can absolutely feel the prayers of those that love me and my family, my sister Tanya and our family. And I just want you to know that I appreciate the strength that God has given me through you guys and through other people that have just been praying for our family. When he talks about that peace that surpasses all understanding, you guys know how I feel about my dad. Maybe you heard. If you don't know, he was my hero, if I could say that, in this earth. But I am so grateful that because of the strength that he has given me, I'm able to stand, and I just didn't know until, you know, having to experience this. But I know it's because of the prayers of the righteous. I know it's because of my relationship with Christ, that I was even able to have that relationship with my father. So I just want to thank all of you guys for your prayers for me and for my family, my sister Tanya, who's also on the call, and to let you know that the peace of God, man, that surpasses all understanding, it is real. I know plenty of you guys can attest to that, but for those of you that don't know, just keep holding on and remain faithful because God is faithful. Thank you.
Amen.
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 Thank
you,
Amen.
Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord.
I know there's someone else. There's someone else has a praise report. I know there is.
Hey, Moni. Good morning. It's Shalandra. I mentioned it earlier, but we have been praying for baby Vanessa. Her mother's a young mother, and I believe she has a tumor in her head, I believe it is. But nevertheless, she may be 18 months old, if that old, but the tumor has shrank. And so I'm just forever grateful for that because only God can do things of that measure, you know, and it's a supernatural power. And like someone said before me, the prayers of the righteous and our faith and our belief and his will that these things come to pass. So continue to pray for her, baby Vanessa. Thank you so much.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We Before we move on, is there anyone else that would have a praise for God? Anyone else that's seen God work or is now seeing God work in something and they just need to give him the praise for it?
Moni, this is Juliet. I just want to just go back and I'm excited about my son becoming a deacon because when he went down to 16 and now he's 30, he'll be 31 soon. But we went down there, raised him in church and everything. And when he got down there and started going to school and he really got into Greek mythology, he stopped believing in God. He was like, he was all into this Greek mythology. And then when I would try to have a conversation with him, he wouldn't talk to me, want to talk to me, especially if I would talk to him about God, he would kind of freeze up. And there became a wedge that... And I realized that, you know, I couldn't do anything but begin to start praying. And I was hoping and saying, Lord, you know, it was like we get into a conversation and the next thing you know, we get angry with each other. And I wouldn't get angry, but he'd get angry with me. And the next thing you know, crying, ready to come home, and he's frustrated. And just to see, turned his life.
Hang on just a second. Can I get everyone to check their phones, please? And please put your phone on mute. We're trying to hear Juliet, and we can't hear her. Sounds like someone's building a house.
It's probably her husband building a house.
Go ahead, Juliet.
I was just going to say that, you know, I just feel like I need to say that for any parent, you know, that's been praying for their child, and even maybe praying for them right now, and it doesn't seem like it's, you know, that it seems like it's not getting through, that, you know, he is able, and that's why I said I was so excited. It was a surprise to me as well as to him that, I've started seeing him go to church and stuff like that, but to see how much God has really worked in his life is beautiful, and that he answered my prayer. The things I asked God for, and I said, before I leave this earth, I want to see my children get married. I want to see them have family, but I want them to see them come closer to you. And so I'm seeing that.
That's great. That's great. I love that, Juliet. Well, if there's no one else that has anything to share, I want to encourage everyone that we can praise the Lord even before he's done anything. That's what we have. That's what we have to hold on to, is to hold on to the fact that if we don't have a praise after, that we have a praise before. And I'm not just speaking to you, I'm speaking to myself. We have the ability to praise before the battle. And we're privileged to be able to praise after the battle. And that's what he does for his children. That is the right that we have today, to praise him before the battle, praise him before the chaos, praise him before the pain and the hurt. We have that right. And then we get the privilege to praise him after. So that in and of itself, I hope, is enough encouragement for all of you and me today. And I thank the Lord for that. I hope you hold on to that. And we hope here on this call that you were blessed by that message by Pamela Anderson on trust. Because the Lord is really doing something in us. And for those of you that were able to call in today, that message was for us. My hope is that you just digest that and hold on to it. Ask for the playback if you called in late. We can certainly get that into your hands through the Victory Room. And as Dion said earlier, we're going to be ending this call early. We're going to give you some time back for the holiday. And We would like you to enjoy this holiday and remember those lost in active military duty throughout the day. We want to thank you for joining us here on Declare Victory, and we hope that you will call back tomorrow. Again, we're a prayer call that meets Monday through Saturday, every morning at 6 a.m. Pacific time. And please invite a friend so that they can be blessed as well. We want you all to have a God-filled day. God bless you, everyone, and go in the love of the Lord.
Have a blessed day, everyone.
Have a blessed day.
Blessings all. Have a blessed day, everyone.
God bless everybody. Have a good day.
Be blessed on purpose.